Next speaker is Professor K.G. Arun from the CMI, and he will tell us about the Indian contribution in the discovery.
It's 15. Okay, I hope you can hear me. Okay, so thanks. So it's great to be here to talk to you about, to follow up about what Ajit told, sharing our excitement about the first discovery of gravitational wave signal with LIGO. And what I'm going to talk in the next 15 minutes or so is to focus about the Indian contribution, starting from from the seminal works of various people, and later part focusing really on in this case of this event, what kind of contributions were made from the Indian from various Indian groups. Okay, so again, as I said, I will just separate into two. The one is the contributions to the foundations, which still is a big thing, as I will show to you. And the second one is specific to this event. So this, if you want to start historically, the first work on the prediction of a quasi-novel mode, where C.B. Vishwesharaya was studying the stability of black holes way back in the 60s, is probably the first one which showed that the existence, there are certain modes called quasi-novel modes which can exist, though it's slightly not quite in this gravitational wave context, but the notion of a quasi-normal mode was first predicted by C.B. Vishwesharaya when he was in the US. But the real theoretical modeling efforts was led by the group of Bala Iyer at the Raman Research Institute for more than two decades. And they were really crucial for driving the experiment. For example, the most promising sources for the gravitational waves are the binaries, either double neutron star, black hole, or black hole, black hole. And they, if you knew the waveforms a priori and accurately, that could be used to do the data analysis where even if the signal is very weak, one could dig it out knowing what you're looking for. So it's like, if you know what you're looking for, it's very easy to extract the signal. And that led the theoretical efforts to calculate more and more accurate waveforms, which could be mostly due to the early phase of the in-spiral or until very, slightly a few orbits before it merges. But still, that was something which was very useful. And one needed to, even with the sensitivity that LIGO had at early stages, it was clear that you need to model it more and more accurately. So the efforts by Bala and also collaboration with the French group and the American group led to the phasing formula, that is the phase of the gravitational wave, which is more important, up to very high accuracy, 3.5 pn. And I understand that he's working on a 4 pn accurate phasing formula now. And this may not be, for this event, which was like a short, extremely short and started very late, this was not directly used. The post-Newtonian waveforms were not used, but it was very important. It's very important to point out that the two methods which were used were called the effective one-body approach and the phenomenological parameterizations. Both of them use in order to, the waveform generation is based on this post-Newtonian waveforms at the low frequency, and then they add on or add more features to the waveform. So the effective one-body and the phenomenological parameterization, which was, I think it's important to highlight, that the phenomenological parameterization is basically that you have got numerical waveforms, numerical latitude waveforms, across the parameter space. And it's very difficult to construct templates if you want to do do cross-correlations. So the Ajit was the first one as part of his graduate thing. He proposed that instead of doing simulations all throughout the parameter space, once you have existing simulations, one could use numerical methods to extrapolate and get an analytical expression which sort of captures all the features of the numerical latitude waveforms across the parameter space. So this was the work that Ajit did. And of course, it was sort of improved later to get this IMR phenom P waveform, which is extended to include precession, spin, and various size of features. But the base of the phenomenological parameterization was from the work of Ajit. But that again happened when he was in Germany, but it doesn't matter. Okay, so I want to emphasize that the EOB and the IMR phenom P were the two waveforms which are used to do the mass filtering in the case of this discovery. So on the other front, the IUCA group had led very strong efforts to understand and devise data analysis strategies. Sanjeev Dhurandhar and his students and postdocs were involved at various stages. One of the fundamental work was about the geometrical aspect of the template placement problem. So how to place template, because templates are various copies of the waveform that is required to do the match filtering. And the work by Sanjeev Dhurandhar, Satya Prakash, and Balasubramaniam at that point was a very geometrical and elegantly geometrical way of approaching the problem, which was carried out and improved and so on. So it's a very fundamental contribution to the data analysis strategies. And the second thing is the analysis of the data analysis for a network of detectors. So we have got two LIGOs, Virgo and maybe Kagra, LIGO India coming up. So the first systematic analysis about how the data analysis should be optimized for a case of detector network was done by as a part of Archana Pai's thesis. She's in ISET Trivandrum now, and Sugandha Bose was a postdoc at that point, and again led by, you know, guided by Sanjeev Dharandar. And there were many other works by his students, Anand Sen Gupta, Sanjit Mitra, Himan, who is no longer with us, and so on, in order to devise data analysis strategies optimized for various LIGO searches. So you know, the Ayuka group has led a great effort in this context. So you can see that experiment, data analysis, and a theory are the three fronts which are related to this the discovery. Both on the theoretical front and the data analysis front, we really have contributed fundamentally to a lot of things in this field. And experiment is, you know, just hopefully coming up. Just now focusing on this event. So the event had to be characterized, as I was mentioning, you had to rule out all the instrumental glitches and what all could mimic the problem. So it is a very complicated problem of analyzing various channels of the detector. And the Ayuka group, led by Sugandha Bose, had done contributed significantly in order to understand how, you know, to reach a statistical significance and so on. So he has been working very closely with the data, with the detector characterization group. So the waveforms, as I said, it's important to keep in mind that the post-Newtonian waveforms were not used. That forms the basis for the development of EOB and the IMR phenom P waveform, which were used and reported to get the signal-to-noise ratio and so on. Now comes the mass and the spin of the remnant black hole. I just showed you this plot. So what is used here is that knowing the, you know, if you know the, from the waveform, you can use the information about the spins of the components and use GR predictions based on the numerical relativity simulations to reach or estimate the final black hole spin. So this is basically using the fitting formulae, which is derived from the numerical relativity simulations, and use that to estimate what could be the final mass and the spin of the final black hole will be. And this is again the ICTS and astronomical group at ICTS has got a big say. So Archishman led the effort, and you know, various other people contributed in various ways. So I think it's very important that, you know, the mass and one of the finest measurements of the mass and the spin of the black hole comes from India, and especially from ICTS. So I have to emphasize that the spins of the individual component black holes, you know, the component black holes are badly estimated due to various correlations, but at least for this system. So one could not measure the individual spins. So now one can ask the question that is the binary circular? We do believe, based on the arguments of radiation reaction, that the radiation reaction would eventually circularize the orbit, even if it was elliptical to start with. But we can ask the question that is there evidence or hint of eccentricity in the, you know, in the observed signal? And the TFR group led by Gopakumar and Maria Hane did many systematic studies using their waveform and found that eccentricity is not, it's not easy to, or the, it's not very sensitive to the eccentricity. So one could not constrain eccentricity, but it is a good study which could be carried out into future depending upon the nature of the sources we get. And I think it's important to highlight that eccentricity can have, you know, if you see a hint of eccentricity, it can give you a lot of information about how the black holes were formed, because it didn't get enough time to circularize and so on. It's very important information in terms of astrophysics. So this study in the case of future events could be very important. Now comes the big one. This is the GR testing using the in-spiral merger ring down. And having seen this idea come up and how it has evolved, it was a very exciting thing for me to see this, you know, this paper first, just ahead of the thing, and the paper, you know, the final figure in the detection paper. So the idea is that if you have an in-spiral merger ring down waveform, these are the three phases of the binary evolution, how the prediction, so the different parts of the waveforms will predict different, have unique predictions for the final mass and the spin of the black hole. So this is what is shown here. So this in spiral is the early part. This is the prediction in the final mass spin plane. And the, after in spiral, whatever is the waveform, this is the second contour that is here. And what is IMR is the total one. If you use the total one, you've got more information, so it will be a narrow contour. So this is the consistency between the predictions from the in-spiral and the post-in-spiral phases and how they agree, if they agree at all or not, because you know, if everything is as predicted by GR, you expect them to agree. If there are issues, if there are problems, you don't expect it to agree. And they showed that it indeed agrees. So this is typically the error in the spin and the mass space. So this is the kind of delta F by F and delta MF by MF. And it's interesting thing is that these are like dimensionless quantities and unique. So with a lot more observations, it can be it can add up, and you can get a more finer constraint on the black hole, on the constraints on the GR. So the young Abhirup Ghosh led the effort, and it was very, you know, very useful contribution, and it was glad to be reported in the test of GR paper, and mentioned in the main detection paper. So this is the quasi-normal mode measurement. This, there was no direct Indian involvement, but it was good to, I think it's good to point out that it is our kind of Guru Dakshina to Vishu. So basically, though one could not, given the signal, one could not really estimate the parameters from the quasi-normal modes and so on, we do see that the signal is consistent with the existence of a quasi-normal mode. Depending upon where you start the mode, you get various contours. So these are the various contours which are there. And essentially, so I think with future observations, maybe more different configurations and so on, we could hope to see a standalone ring-down signal and talk about various tests that you would want to perform on a black hole. But this was not so optimal for that purpose. So this is another idea which has come from India, from works of RRI, with Bala, Chandra, me, and so on. So basically, idea is that the post-Newtonian phasing formula has got different coefficients which appear. And one can ask the question that the observation, if one have, is it consistent with the GR prediction? GR prediction is what we have. But we can ask whether it is consistent with the predictions of GR. So there were various ways in which it can be done, and we had discussed this two, three papers. And it was nice that it could be implemented by the work of the Amsterdam group. It could be implemented in an algorithmic way, and it was run on the real data of this GW 15-09-14. And these are the bounds. So this is shown the post-Newtonian order, that is the post-Newtonian bounds on the various post-Newtonian coefficients, and this delta phi, which is shown here. So what is shown here is the binary pulsar thing is the blue one. Of course, you can see that after the first one, the binary pulsar bounds are very weak, so we are not shown the whole scale, so because it's so weak that we don't want to show it. But this gravitational event has indeed given us a very good constraint on the various post-Newtonian orders, which is one of the interesting things. It's good to, and it's again important to point out that this is one of the area where a lot of Indian groups, ISR Trivandrum and ISR Kolkata, contributed, including young graduate students like Anuradha Samizdar and Muhammad Salim, and also Rajesh Naik and Archana Pai were also crucially involved. So this is something, it's another effort which has come from India, and we could contribute towards getting it done on the real gravitational wave event. So this is another one which is related to the mass of the graviton. So based on the propagation effects, you can try to quantify whether are there hints of mass of the graviton in the observed signal. The basic idea is that different waveform components arrive at different time. If there is it's like a dispersion relation that you are probing, and whether it's different from that of DR, and you can constrain the Compton wavelength of graviton based on the observations, and which can be translated into a mass. And the bound that we have got is much better than the solar system bound, the static bounds, by a factor of 3. And the only dynamical bound is from binary pulsars, and it is much better than by a factor of 1,000 with respect to the binary pulsar bound. So this is typically the one, and it's important to point out that there was initially the number which we got was high, and it was slightly confusing why it was there, and it was pointed out that if you use the in-spiral merge and ring down, the bounds are extremely likely to go up because there is a lot more signal and your error estimates go down. So this is something which I could contribute to in terms of the interpretation and analysis. So the last, this is the plot that Ajit showed, where you got the electromagnetic follow-ups were carried out, but with the large error bar of the order of 600 square degrees, it was not an easy task to do. We did send a trigger, and those groups were asked to follow up if they wanted. And it was indeed follow-up, but the details will come up in a joint paper, which will be written in collaboration with other electromagnetic group. And I think the IUC, so of course, the basic lesson first we know is that it is too huge to carry out anything, any interesting electromagnetic follow-up. So it is very important that we do get a network of detectors spread over the globe, which can considerably reduce the error bars with the sky, which would enable the electromagnetic follow-ups better. But so for that, getting a Japanese detector and an Indian detector and so on are very very important. And again, the Indian effort is led mostly by the IUCA group, Varun Bhale Rao, Sukanta Bose, Javed Rana, Bhushan Gadre, and Singhal, and so on. So they were actually involved, and I know that they are developing techniques, more efficient techniques to really follow up such things in future. So this is a summary. So there is significant contributions from the Indian scientists towards the discovery and the consequent analysis of the GW 15-09-14. And especially the Astrotel group has contributed significantly in various ways, including the parameter estimation and the test of GR, which and it's quite a it's quite an amazing occasion to say that. I'll stop that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Arun, for a very nice talk. We have time for a few questions. I'm not sure. There are a couple of, let me start there.
So when you say it's a test of GR, do you mean that you rule out higher derivative theories of gravity?
No. So we are saying is that we are finding that the signal is consistent with GR. We don't see any deviation. Because in order to rule out it, you need more, to be formulated a bit more better and so on. But
if I can say, you could presumably, the fact that the post-Newtonian approximation works well to several orders should allow you to bound coefficients.
Correct. Is it to be now, probably that range is what is allowed probably, but generic statements are difficult to make. If you have waveforms for different models, you could constrain those parameters, but that is not easy to get across different alternative models. The free coefficients, easy to compute the waveforms up to that order and so on. So, but eventually I think we should come up with more of the.
Okay. There was one here. Yeah, Ajay.
If I understand correctly, the original Vishu's work had to do with the fact that it was a simple gravitational pulse hitting a stationary gravitational potential.
Right.
But here we have a highly dynamic situation with the potential varying so rapidly.
Yes.
Would you still expect quasi-normal modes of the kind that Vishu described in 1970 or? How important is to know that these are quasi-normal modes to identify with GR predictions?
Yeah, so I think the quasi-normal modes are used in a very general context. It is talking about how if a black hole is perturbed by an external perturbation, how it reacts is what I mean by quasi-normal mode. But I agree that the quasi-normal mode thing we showed, I cannot say that it is consistent with GR or not, because we have to have more data. We have to have a more reliable detection of that part itself to talk about whether it is existing, agreeing exactly with GR or not. So I am not saying that the quasi-normal mode type signature is exactly as predicted by GR. I'm saying that there is a signature or the data is consistent with the existence of a quasi-normal mode. That's all what we can say. But I cannot say that we detected quasi-normal mode is a very strong statement.
Actually, if I can just follow up on that, I was a little confused about two things you said.
Yeah.
You said that from just the quasi-normal ring down part of the waveform,
yes.
One can't extract the mass and spin of the final black hole because it's not accurate enough.
Yeah.
On the other hand, you showed a contour plot of parameters extracted from the final ring down part and you tested its consistency.
Yeah.
Now, how did you produce that contour if you're not able to...
No. So I think
I missed that. If you can just show that part.
Yeah. So I just meant that the mass and for this signal... So in principle, if you have a ring down, it's only in terms of mass and spin. If you have, for example, different modes, you can extract out, using these two modes, you can extract out the mass and spin, in principle. But given the specification of this signal, one cannot do a standalone estimation of the mass and spin just from the ring down part of this waveform. That's what I meant. So what is done here is that the plot is basically the quasi-normal damping time and the frequency. These are the two parameters which would describe the quasi-normal mode. And so the question is that where do you start your ring down? So you've got a waveform which you reconstructed. So if you start, so these are the times where you start your ring down. If you start, for example, 3 milliseconds after the peak or the one, so this is a constraint that you get in this plane, the time decay time frequency plane. And if the orange one is if you take 7 milliseconds after that, then of course the SNR is so low that you don't get good constraint. But you can also see that if you start 1 millisecond after that, it is inconsistent. It's totally different. So it surely means that if you start immediately after, it's not consistent. But the other thing, depending upon where you start, you're going to get, you do get the quasi-normal mode-like signatures.
I see.
So, yeah.
Okay, but can you go one further back where you had a plot? There, when you have the post in the, post in spiral.
Yeah.
There you do have the final spin and the final mass.
So this is
how did you get that contour plot if you can't extract the...
Right. So I think the GR numerical simulations predicts that if you are given a system of masses with M1 and M2, S1 and S2, let's say, how this will map onto the final mass and spin.
Mm-hmm.
So what is used here is that if you know the masses, component masses accurately, or the component spins at some level, mm-hmm. you can map them onto the final mass and spin. So this is using a fitting formula.
Okay.
So you use that information and use the estimations based on the component masses to infer the final spin. It's not okay. an estimation per se.
I see. It's not a measurement. It's an inference from GR.
And it's quite accurate. And it's only GR is going into the picture. So you don't expect anything else to play a role. But strictly speaking, you would like it to come from the ring down, as you said. From a ring down, you can extract out the mass and spin. That is a stronger evidence. But here we are using the GR particular based on the simulations, what we are doing.
I see. Thank you. Sorry to take. Maybe we'll take, but please do. Let's see. Okay, yeah, sure. Maybe here and then Surat. Yeah, go ahead.
Just to follow up on that, what is the, you know, what are the uncertainties related to, for example, inclination, angle, and eccentricity? And are there degeneracies related to that and, you know, this, what just Sandeep asked?
The questionable mode thing or in general?
You know, everything, you know.
Yeah, so I think, for example, the distance estimation, for example, is very bad because of the strong degeneracy between the inclinational angle and the distance, because they both appear in the amplitude of the waveform. They are strongly degenerate, and I did not show you the posterior of the inclination angle, which is even bad. It's a very wide posterior. So that is one thing. Eccentricity, if it's present, it would have shown up. It would have sort of biased, but what the study showed is that there is no, you know, the even if eccentricity was as low as like 0.1 and so on, it wouldn't have biased it so much unless there is some high eccentricity, which we don't see anyway. That means since we don't get any strong biases, they conclude that one cannot constrain eccentricity and we cannot put any constraints. But we are not that sensitive to eccentricity.
And the spins, you know, the relative spins of the initial black, you know, right. There's a lot of parameter
right.
space.
Right. So I think spins are strongly correlated with masses because you try to extract them all together. And what is possible, so you cannot extract out the individual spin components. There are certain combinations of the spin components that you can extract better. Again, I did not show you the posterior. There's some effective parameter. It's like some linear combination of the chi1 and chi2, let's say. Those can be estimated slightly better. But that's one parameter, which is like a combination of both. Extracting both chi1 and chi2, or the S1 and S2, is very difficult, at least with this kind of a signal.
Surat.
I was wondering if you could explain a little more what you did when you said you bounded the mass of the graviton.
Yeah.
Because bounding the mass of the graviton, I would have thought if you add even a small mass, it actually leads to a discontinuous change. There's a VDVZ discontinuity.
Yeah, so I think
I'm a little confused about what you mean when you say you bound the mass.
Yes. So I think we are not looking into the theoretical waveform that comes from any massive graviton theory, because we did not have anything to take it from. So what Clifford will propose is that if the graviton has a mass, it will affect the propagation definitely. It would mean that the dispersion relation that we will see will be different from GR. There'll be mg square C4 type term. So that means there's a dispersion and a Compton wavelength associated with that. So it's just based on the different arrival times of different wave components that we can, it will be a time difference which will translate into phase shift. Phase shift is what we call phasing. So he argued that because of the propagation effect, you can have a change in the 1pn term of the phasing coefficient, and that you can bound. That is a bound we are talking about, not from any, you know, waveform coming from a theory or in at that level. It's mostly a propagation effect, not from a anything.
Okay, if there's a really urgent question, we should move on. Rajesh is signaling to me, so.